watching it come true. It's taking over you. Oh, this is the greatest show.
Howdy, y'all. Clay Cooper here, Tourist Tuesday, visiting with my friend Billy Yates. How are you, Billy?
I'm great. How are you, brother?
I'm good, man.
Good to be here.
It's good to have you. Tell us about your new show.
You know, Hit Songwriters In The Round. It's called Billy Yates Hit Songwriters In The Round.
And that's a clever name.
I like it.
It's a good name.
just has a ring to it.
It does.
I got here, fell in love with Branson, but really, you know, there were things about Nashville. Of course, Nashville was home for 30 years. There were things that I missed about it. One of the biggest things I missed about Nashville was my songwriting buddies. Mm-hmm. And because I'd spent so much time just sitting in little rooms with them, you know, trying to come up with songs and stuff, there's a lot of co-writing goes on there. And so, there's just such a great, you know, songwriting community in Nashville anyway. And I was missing those people, but I also realized that there was a need for something like this show, something that changed every week. We bring two different songwriters in from Nashville every week, and they perform big hits that they wrote for all the big stars, tell the stories that inspired those songs, or how they got those songs recorded. So you really get a behind the scenes look at, you know, the world of songwriting and country music in general, the business side of it. And it's also just very entertaining. But I realized when I fell in love with Branson, I wanted to bring these people over to show them Branson. Mm-hmm. There's another whole side to this city. So it's not just wanting to bring these songwriters in so we got this show, but there's also a side of it that really matters to me. I want them to come here and fall in love with Branson just like I did. Things in Nashville are changing a lot. It's grown really fast, you know, and there's not as many opportunities for songwriters, you know, to make a living writing songs. It's not what it used to be. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, you create a vehicle for them to go out and do what they do, perform and do those songs that we all have listened to forever. Once you hear the songwriter do it, you never hear that song the same after that.
That's,
you
know? Right.
Yeah.
And that's what's cool about, you know, you're bringing in, every week, you do three shows a week at the Americana Theater.
Right.
And every week you bring in two different songwriters, right?
Yeah.
And you showcase them. You have this beautiful set that you built yourself, which is crazy. And it's just, it's a real kind of a laid back, in your living room type setting, and you're on these big tall stools, and they're telling stories, and this guy, hey, sing that one you wrote for Merle Haggard, and hey, sing, you know, do that one you wrote for, you know.
It's totally unscripted, you know, so everything is just kind of off the cuff. I start the show every show with choices. Mm-hmm. Song I wrote for George Jones.
I've had choices since the day I was born. There were voices that told me right from wrong. If I had listened.
What happens after that is so we have a beginning. This is how we started.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, and what happens after that is just whatever it is.
I love that. And you know what's cool for the like you said, for the tourist that comes to Branson, you know, like for me and my show, you know, I'm doing cover tunes. I'm doing songs that people like you wrote for other artists, and these people come in and they recognize the song because they've heard Alan Jackson singing, or they've heard Travis Tritt singing, or whatever, and that's cool. But with you, it's a whole different twist on it, because they're going to come see you guys, and they're going to hear these songs from the guys that actually wrote it, not, you know, the guy that wrote that, and that's cool, you know, because I think people want to know, you know, do you ever get questions from people in the audience like, what made you? How did you come up with the idea to write Rocking Chair? Or how did you come up with the idea to write this?
Yeah, you get all kinds of, and usually, now we don't open, like during the show, we've talked about doing that, because it would take a lot of time to do that. Because I think people have a lot of questions.
They do.
So we try to get as much music in and just tell the stories, and that kind of thing is kind of the way we do the show. But after the show, you hear a lot of questions about, I was wondering about how did you, you know, in this song, did you write that just for that, you know? And so, you know, you start to pick, you know, so when you tell the story, you start to pick up on those things too. And so we tell the story a little bit. We add to the story and give them more information.
So you're hearing the questions in the lobby.
It's like, but then they want to know, did you write this specifically for that artist? Or, you know, or did, How long did it take? You know, how many years did that song sit around? Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of people think, well, you wrote it and you get it to them and they record it and boom, you know. It's yeah. like, and most time that's not the case.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it happens, but you know, so many times that's just not the case. And you know, Choices sat around, wrote that song in 94, and George Jones finally did it in 99.
Really?
So it sat around for 5 years, you know, just nothing, you know.
You had pushed the song, obviously,
yeah.
push and not yeah. a lot of bites, and then all
and
of
I played it for George twice.
Really?
And he passed on it, you know, and then finally, you know, but yeah, you know, Alan Jackson, I was doing shows in 97 with Alan. I was opening for Alan. I did a few shows with him, and he would play that song all the time. He'd sit around and sing it with his guitar. He's like, you know, before the show or after, whatever. And I just knew he was going to record that song. Yeah. And he never did, you know. He did it on the awards show. If you remember, George Jones was first to do a piece of the song on the awards show. And he said, it's all or nothing. And so George boycotted the CMAs that year.
I remember
stayed
that.
Home.
Yeah.
And Alan walked out and did a little bit of it. But, you know, they sort of, you know, have a life of their own, it seems like, you know. And they can, you know, they can sit around forever. Then all of a sudden, and that song, Choices, Leonard Cohen ended up recording that song too, different ones, and now Joe Nichols has just recorded it. Oh. So songs like that will have, they will have a life forever, you know. And so that's the great thing about songwriting is, you know, you write these songs and they sit around, and it might be something that, you know, I might not see a certain song get recorded, but my son or my grandkids or whatever, it could happen. They're always
that's
yours.
True.
They're always yours. They're always your property, you know.
And yeah, so I mean, kids, 30 years down the road, the new artists of that time may do Choices again.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
there might be a pop version or something. Who knows? I mean, you don't know what could happen. Anything can happen with these songs. So yeah,
isn't that something?
Yeah,
yeah. And that's really cool. The whole songwriting thing. I've written some stuff as a kid. You know, messing around and this and that. And I've written maybe 40, 50 songs. And I think maybe three of them's, you know, good.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you find yourself doing that writing, like,
all the time. I mean, you know, I think over the, you know, course of my songwriting career, I think I've written well over 2,000 songs, and a lot of them aren't any good.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of them. But, you know, it gets to a point where it's like, you know, the more you write and the more songs you finish up and you know, whatever, then the odds are always going to be a little bit better that you get a good one every once in a while.
Because you're throwing more out there. One of them's going to stick.
Yeah, one's going to stick.
You ever write one that you thought was, it's okay, not really that good, and it turned out to be a hit?
Well, I had a funny thing happen. I was writing one time with a guy who played guitar for Gary Allen, and I was in a hurry. I was needing to go. I was probably on a date with Nancy, probably. I think we were dating back then before we got married, and I was trying to, I was in a hurry, and he's like, come by the hotel, we've got this song I want to write. And so I ran by and we just wrote it real fast. I was just like, yeah, that's good, 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 whatever. And it rhymes, let's go, you know. It's like,
it
you know.
Rhymes.
And didn't think too much of it, you know. And so went on my way. And a few days later, I get a call from the guy who worked at the MCA where I was writing at the time. And he said, did you write a song called I Got a Quarter? I got a quarter in my pocket. Quarter in My Pocket, I think is the name of the song.
He can't even remember the name of the song.
And I said, I think so. He said, well, Gary Allen just did it at the CRS and said it's his next single. And they'd gone in and recorded it. We wrote that song, and then like next day, so they were in the studio working on a record. That's why he was in town. And they go in and record the song. And so now Mark Chestnut has recorded it. Different ones have done it. Like, and it was just a song I didn't think anything about.
Isn't that something?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because you don't know what one artist is looking for or what they're feeling or what they hear that you may not hear in it, you know.
Well, then I'll be able to look back later and go, yeah, it is a really cool song,
yeah.
You know. But yeah. I just at the time I just didn't think much of it, you know. And so, you know, a lot of songs are like that, I think. And then there's songs that you think are really special and nothing happens,
yeah.
You know.
The ones you're really yeah. dear to, like, no, but that's
yeah.
meh.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what name some of your big hits that you've written for artists.
You know, I've had songs recorded by George Strait, Kenny Chesney, Sarah Evans, Joe Nichols, John Michael Montgomery, Sammy Kershaw, Rhonda Vincent, Gene Watson, Doug Stone, Ricky Van Shelton, Oak Ridge Boys. So I've been very blessed. I've had a lot of songs recorded.
Yeah.
I had George Jones recorded 6 of my songs. Four of those ended up being singles, two of which got substantial airplay, being Choices and I Don't Need Your Rocking Chair. There was another song called The Lone Ranger.
Yeah, which I love. I just told Billy before we got here, I'm like, I was looking at stuff up on the website. I'm like, Lone Ranger, it wasn't a single, right?
But it
was
an
album cut. And it's the coolest song. It's called The Lone Ranger. And I'm looking down, I'm like, Billy wrote that. Because I used to sing it all the time. I've never done it on stage, but what's the hook?
I had more silver bullets last night than the Lone Ranger. Yeah, Lone Ranger. Yeah.
What a great tune.
More silver bullets last night than the Lone Ranger.
Which could be bullets or Coors Light.
Yeah, a little Coors Light.
I love it. That's such a cool song.
There was a song called Honky Tonk Song that, not the Mel Tillis Honky Tonk Song.
Right.
There was a song wrote for George about the whole riding lawnmower deal. And, George was notorious for, living it up.
Yeah.
Living big. And so he was, his wife took away the keys to the car because he's going to the liquor store, bar too much, whatever. But she forgot about the keys to the riding lawnmower. And so he took the lawnmower to the liquor store, I think. And anyway, so we wrote a song about that.
I need a honky-tonk song. A cold, cold beer. A hardwood floor, a smoky atmosphere.
Your show at the Americana is definitely unique. There's not another show in town like it. You're not going to go to any other theater up and down the strip and see you and two other people sitting up there singing hit songs that they wrote and telling the stories behind them and how they came about.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's a great thing, man. So if you guys... thank you, Billy, for visiting with us. You guys come to Branson. If you're coming to Branson or if you're planning on coming to Branson, you have to go see Billy's show at the Americana. Tell them a little bit about it.
We have it's called Hit Songwriters In The Round. It's at the Americana Theater. The phone number is 417-544-8700.
Is there a website?
There's a website, hitsongwritersintheround.com. And you can go there to find out who's playing any given week. And so you see the schedule. We'll have shows through... mid-December. Mm-hmm. We'll take a couple weeks off in August, and then we have shows straight through the middle part of December. And so it's something different every weekend. So
yeah, every week it's a different artist.
Yeah, so they drive 8 hours from Nashville. Mm-hmm. Two people come over, the three of us sit up there and do these songs and tell the stories behind them, and then three shows, then they head back to Nashville, then two more drive over.
That's awesome.
Every week.
So you can get online, you can look and see who the artists are, and find a couple of songs like, oh my, I love that song. This guy that wrote it's going to be here that week, and you can book it and come see the guy that wrote the song that you love.
Yeah.
It's that easy.
Yeah, absolutely.
So check out Billy's website. We'll put the information on the screen, phone numbers. And when you're in Branson, come see Billy Yates.
Hit Songwriters in the Round
at the Americana Theater, which is right down the street from the Clay Cooper Theater. By the way, I have a show too.
There you go.
Thanks for tuning in for Tourist Tuesday. My friend Billy Yates, y'all come to Branson and see us.
This is the greatest show.